Very happy to be here. So what I plan to do today is to tell you a bit about the structure of this book, which is called Entreprecariat. And Entreprecariat is a portmanteau word that, as you probably assumed already, connects two words, which is entrepreneurship or entrepreneurialism, as we will see, and precarity. I don't know how common the word precarity is here, but just to give, I think like Elisa already described it very well, but of course it deals with a condition of uncertainty and instability that is both professional, material, economical, and also existential. The book came out last year in Italian for Crisis Publishing. And it includes two appendixes, a foreword by Gert Lovink, a Dutch media theorist, and an afterword by Raffaele Alberto Ventura. So I choose this this book by Gert Lovink because it shows that the reason why I asked him to write the foreword is because like already 10 years ago he was somehow criticizing, reflecting critically on this idea of creativity as an economic panacea for many countries. At the time, creativity would have been considered like the solution, the economical solution for all problems in a post-Fordist economy. And already then, when at the maximum hype of things like Richard Florida, if you know a bit about it, they were already like raising a bit of issues. While on the other side, Raffaele wrote this book, which I struggled to translate it in English because it's a pun on a book by an economist called Veblen. And what Raffaele attempted to do was to read like the situation of middle class in decrease, let's say, in decline, through the lens of conspicuous consumption. And what you find in his book is this idea of two narratives conflicting, which is also present in my book. It's what he calls a bit controversially class dysphoria. So as in the typical entrepreneurial and startup world, I would like to start with an origin story. Origin story is this this article that came out on like the biggest, one of the biggest newspaper in Italy when I was 29. The headline reads, 10 years studying design, 100 job application requests. So the story goes that I was asked by this journalist to provide a profile of my work, my activity as both designer and researcher. And of course, as you can imagine, I tried to give a sort of positive profile, a profile in which I would show my excitement and my proactiveness somehow. So it was quite of a shock when I got like the actual title, and especially with have you ever seen an emoticon, an emoji next to a title in a newspaper? It was like, oh, wow. And not only an emoji, but a sad one. So I felt like there was this stamp on my own career. So I also felt that I was somehow manipulated and exploited to project what I consider a generational cliché, which is partly true. So I was sort of disappointed, but at the same time, after a bit I started to think, okay, but what kind of narrative is more real? Is the one I try to project about myself or the one that the journalists decide to apply? Also because I said those things, it's not that I denying saying those. And also my scholarship was finishing, I was kind of scared. So this is what led me a bit to formulate this clash of narratives that I think they are very well organized and reframed, summarized by a philosopher, a German philosopher called Byung-Chul Han. So the idea that we tend to reject the idea of being subjugated, but we consider ourselves projects, so always refashioning and reinventing ourselves. So how does this refashioning and reinvention happen? So like, where does it come, the rhetoric and the narrative around this kind of entrepreneurial approach to our own life story, let's say? And I have to begin, like, go quite back in time and speak about an Austrian economist called Joseph Schumpeter. He's well known for this concept of creative destruction that you might have heard, this idea that products and services don't progress by optimizing themselves, but really by destroying each other somehow. And also for this, the concept of Unternehmergeist, which can be translated as entrepreneurial spirit. So this was the idea of society that Schumpeter had. So on the very basis, and this is his words, an hedonist mass. Hedonist in terms of, like, too busy not to perish, to dedicate to more higher endeavors. On the, let's say, the middle, like a smaller minority, would be occupied by inventors, by people able to come up with new ideas. But finally, on the very top of the societal structure, we would have entrepreneurs, a very small minority that is defined by their capacity to act and to transform inventions into products and services. So this is, like, already in at the beginning of the century how Schumpeter would describe the role of the entrepreneur. He's one of the first to theorize on, like, what the entrepreneur does in society and to dedicate so much attention to this, to him, I would say, because at the time entrepreneurs were predominantly male. So he would speak of the entrepreneur as, like, someone who scorns the hedonic equilibrium and faces risk without timidity. And this is, like, the literature that comes from economics. So you wouldn't expect this literary description of like a role in society. So I want to show how this the narrative around, like, this heroic narrative around the entrepreneur progressed through the decades. So if we make a big jump and we go to a textbook of entrepreneurship, we see again, like, this sort of moralization of entrepreneurship. So working hard, intense commitment, optimism, this idea of seeing the cup half full, burning with the competitive desire to excel and win, and using failure as a tool for learning. Other, on the most popular level of, like, entrepreneurship is described, and this, I think, connects a bit to phrenology, was a pseudoscience of understanding the character of a person through the shape of their skull. You can imagine how this would work. And so you would see what are the characterial features of an entrepreneur, which I would like to highlight the one, especially the big part, which is the ability to create your own reality, so to deny a certain reality, which is a bit what was happening in the article I was talking about. And finally, this is Reid Hoffman. This is a misquote to Reid Hoffman, which is the guy who co-founded LinkedIn, that generalizes the condition of the entrepreneur. So we see that at the very beginning, entrepreneurship is something dedicated to a minority. And in a period of, like, a century, it becomes something somehow required and naturalized to every human being. If I had to recap briefly, like, the arguments in the book, what I would say is that there are, like, two things. One is entrepreneurship, which is, like, the basic practice of risking and investing a capital in a new enterprise. And on the other side, something that you could call entrepreneurialism, which is clearly ideological, has its own rhetoric and its value system. And there is a feedback loop between this entrepreneurialism, this ideological understanding of entrepreneurship, and precarity, according to dynamics. One is to encourage precarity by asking to risk and to accept change as if it was a natural and always healthy thing, but at the same time, delegitimizing what the precarity discourse would raise as concerns, so being afraid of certain changes or considering not healthy certain approaches to one's own life. And the paradoxical thing is that entrepreneurialism requires precarity to solve its own situation by using entrepreneurialism as a tool. And you can see that the important notion common to both lenses on reality is like this idea of change. So one would see fearfulness in it, and the other one would approach it with enthusiasm. So to show a bit like this idea, this dichotomy, let's say, between entrepreneurship and entrepreneurialism, you can say that this entrepreneurship has like a very factual definition. So the activity of setting up a business, taking on financial risk in the hope of profit. While entrepreneurialism, you can see the signals of this ideological approach. So for example, statements such as entrepreneurship are the catalyst of innovation and progress. Imagine all the mythology and the apology of people like Steve Jobs. The idea that gig workers are turning into entrepreneurs, for example, the workers on Fiverr are called micro entrepreneurs. And this idea that having a regular job is not like something to a stable job, but a traditional job is not something to consider like worthy. And finally, this idea that freedom equates with the idea of being your own boss. So all these tropes emerges and becomes somehow radicalized in the gig economy. Again, you can map this idea of change, this emotional relation to change and future, according to a spectrum of between fear and enthusiasm. And to give an idea of like how on the internet this can be, entrepreneurialism becomes common sense, I'm going to show these two memes. So you might know Bill. This is a common meme that plays on the idea of like what is good sense, what is common sense to do online. So Bill is on the internet, Bill's move on, Bill is smart, be like Bill. This meme has many iterations, and this was the one that caught my attention, using the same common sense idea, but with Elon. And you can see in the description of like what Elon does, there is this idea of triumph of like will. So Elon wanted something, he got it. And it goes on and on. And what you see at the very end is what I was saying about this delegitimization of precarity. So Elon does not tell everybody how bad the world is. He doesn't complain. It's just changing the world. So this is for me like a good manifestation of entrepreneurialism as ideology. And this is summarized in somehow the slogan of the book, which is entrepreneurship applied to all humanity somehow. And this idea that safety is not allowed to anyone, and yet should be something to welcome with the happiness, with enthusiasm. So the chapter of the book that I would like to talk about is the one dedicated to time. Of course, if you are in an entrepreneurial endeavor, you want to optimize as much as you can the time at your hand. So what I did in this chapter is to look at the personal solution to organize your own time, and in particular to the application that people install to prevent themselves from procrastinating. So one is called Productivity Owl. It's, you install it on the browser, it's a plugin, and what it does is like what you see here. There is like for every page, this owl that when the time expires, it travels to the top of your browser and it will close the tab. And the funny thing is that you can click on it and stop it and try to stop it, but then it will start screaming. So there are like very imaginative solutions to punish yourself somehow for the for this kind of procrastination thing. Another one, which is more normy, let's say, is called Rescue Time, which categorizes the time spent online. So you can see already like the quantified self and the self-monitoring that you can apply to your own daily activity. Another one is called the Isolator. And basically what it does is like make everything dark. And the only window is the one that on which you are working. That reminded me quite directly to this invention by Hugo Gernsback. This is again like from the beginning of the century. Hugo Gernsback is like a pioneering science fiction writer. And this was on Popular Mechanics, so it was like taken serious at the time. You can see this as a sort of like something similar to noise canceling headphones, this very physical way of isolating oneself that is not science fiction somehow anymore. Maybe some of you use something like Pomodoro time, which is a technique of working in small bursts, which was invented by an Italian who did it for his own thesis. And of course, the symbol of this technique became the Pomodoro clock that you can see in this slide. But in the book, what I try to understand is what we mean by procrastination and how does it relate to this kind of technique. These scholars identify three features of what procrastination can be. So it is counterproductive, unnecessary, and it causes delay. But the danger with this kind of definition is that when we are in a utilitarian and a productivist mindset, it's very easy to be tempted to apply those categories to any activity that is out of work. So what is counterproductive? It's an holiday, it's self-care counterproductive. It is really unnecessary to take the weekend off. So it's like a very relative categorization. And this idea that procrastination is strictly linked to a more general idea of labor comes already in the work of philosophers like Theodor Adorno, which was speaking of free time as just a shadowy continuation of labor, so a way to recharge your batteries in favor of labor. I was caught by this idea by Melissa Gregg, this idea that what we have seen in all these applications and plugins is not so much just a way to actually control the time, but an actual aesthetic form, something that gives you an idea of controlling time. By just doing that, like the idea of to-do list, already makes you a tease. So there is like something aesthetic, strongly aesthetic about it, that is not just functional, but it's also not related just to oneself to feel good with themselves, but also with other people. This is the book which I strongly suggest by Melissa Gregg. It's called Counterproductive. We see this idea of showing that we control our time and that we are busy and productive. Also, in little strategies applied, for example, in the office. This is a beautiful project just about that by a duo, a graphic design duo, which is called Cox and Grusenmeier. And it's called Bureau for Business. And their effort was, again, to define the aesthetic of busyness, of being busy, and by creating like a series of office tools that would show this. This kind of enthusiasm connected to the amount of time we work was also in this sweatshirt created by the Apple financial department in the 80s. The funny thing is that one of the engineers at a certain point quitted Apple and just crossed the nine, and it would say 0 hours work per week and loving it. So he sort of changed his mind. So we have seen through this all this series of examples what I would call an entrepreneurial time. So a time that wants to show to yourself the idea of controlling, to be autonomous, and to be like the master of your own time. So on the other side, we have another reality, which I think it was nicely described by an artist and scholar, which is Heito Steyer. You probably know her. And this idea of junk time. So I think we can relate to this idea, so of fragmentation, of broken down, of discontinuous. So I think this managerial approach to time is a bit of a response, a bit fictional to the real issue with this time that broken up and we don't have much control on it. Another aspect which I find kind of interesting is how much the digital experience somehow has maintained for a long time, like using our screens, a certain homogeneity. I mean, it doesn't matter to the computer if it's night or day or to the internet, and it will always look the same until people will start to develop tools like Flux. Which some of you might use. I added this slide today because I was reading this article by William Gibson, the one who, another science fiction writer. And I was fascinated by how he was describing cyberspace already in 82. There was a lot of references and metaphors to light, already this idea of hallucination. Now it refers to light, so lines of light, like city lights. So I think that in the light aspect, there is a lot to say. My statement would be that, yeah, as I said, like the same bluish light defines the atemporality that is unique and unbroken by the actual activity, by tiredness, by what we call circadian rhythm, the way that our bodies adapt to day and night. Until, as I was saying, like tools like flux were implemented. So it's like what we call night mode. So at night it adapts to the time in the day. And I thought this was really, really brilliant somehow. And it's sort of revolutionary what it does. In a way, it doesn't really affect the culture of working at night, also because the screen is somehow what defines both leisure and work. And I guess this meme explains it really well, that still the operational logic of work and leisure is somehow defined by the same window frame. So it's stay focused. So what stay focused is, again, it's an app with plenty of users, almost 1 million, that blocks, again, your social media after a certain time. What I was fascinated about, it was like also the way that the developer would describe it. So the idea that he hadn't had any spare time since 1994. The app requires you, in order to change the settings, to retype a very again like ascetic text on what procrastination is and why it's so bad. So without making any mistakes, without making any single type. Otherwise, you have to uninstall it in order to check Twitter or Facebook. But the nice thing, the interesting thing, was like to be surprised of or like going to a social media or like a time sucking website after the time was over. So this is what I got, like this big blunt headline saying, okay, shouldn't you be working? I thought it was just representing what was already internalized, let's say, in my mentality. Already I felt guilty not to be working. So I thought, okay, let's take it out of the screen and let's turn it into a sort of social dystopia. And also it reminded me an opposite kind of slogan, which is Ne travaille jamais by Guy Debord in France, never work, which was turned into a postcard named Le Conseil Superflus, the superfluous advices. So I won't go into this, but this is like, I thought, okay, if this is the case, if it's the kind of guilt that everyone is somehow feeling, let's turn it into a day-live kind of dystopia. So I started making a sticker and distributed it to people, and people started to put it in sort of weird places, in the fridge, connecting to other slogans that are somehow related, hack it, of course. And I also started then to make like site-specific installation. This is in Rijeka, so this banner would supervise, let's say, the exhibition. And finally, we have like the version here in Ljubljana, in a nice shot that compare it, that brings it together to Jonas' work. And this is somehow the way it will work with this. Define, it can be read, I think, as defining the gallery space as a sort of crime scene in which leisure is not allowed. Or at the same time, you could read it maybe as the idea that even in a leisurely space, maybe you should be working and, I don't know, do networking or like take notes about the pieces, etc. So it has a bit like this Ulay feeling, Abramovich and Ulay feeling. To conclude, is that it's fundamentally a simple piece. I didn't have to work much, you know. I make like a very complex piece in relation to this. And this is yet what allows me, let's say, to take some leisure time by replicating in a sort of conceptual artist fashion, by redoing the same thing over and over for years, to take my leisure time. One thing that I think it's important to say is that, and it's an intuition that I advance in the conclusion of the book, is that I think in order to reclaim time, one has to restart from the space. So from the fact that space can be reopened to let's say, creating non-logistic temporalities. So like a time that dominates space, you can consider like the airport, where everything is logistically organized. Another one, like the opposite, a space influencing time and not caring too much of time, is like the church. So I guess in order to reclaim time, one should start from space, to reclaiming space. And I conclude with this, again, from this quote with Melissa Gregg, that has to do with this idea of atmosphere. So in order to reclaim time, one has to create atmospheres of social connection. So to outside some temporal dictates, which is one of these is like this very presentation. So I'm gonna thank you very much.